Good morning. I'm Counselor Sean Neeson, and welcome to the regular meeting of the East Kildonan Transcona Community Committee. Today is October 25th, I believe, leading into Halloween. I'm joined today by council colleagues Jeff Brawati for North Kildonan and Counselor Schreier for East Kildonan Elmwood. Also joined here by multiple members of the public service. Tamara Pimensky, always present for our committees, and much appreciated the work her and the team do. I'd like to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of the Métis Nation, Treaty 1 and Dakota Nations territory. All right.
Read past motions about for the minutes.
Any announcements?
Does anyone have any announcements?
Council colleagues, anything? No? The only thing I have, I want to thank Steve Strang and the Red River Basin Commission for a recent tour that they took me on of the Netley Marsh project, pilot project that they're undertaking. It was very eye-opening, and hopefully that we can do more in future years with regards to that. The city of Winnipeg did contribute to that project, and that's money that was well received. And of course, you know, we need to do what we can to restore the lungs of the lake.
We just need motions, minutes, meeting held on September 27th.
Counselor Brawati, you want to move the minutes there?
I'll move the September 27th minutes.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, carried. Want to move the, Counselor Schreier moves the minutes of the resident advisory group.
So moved.
Okay, all in favor? Opposed, carried.
We'll proceed into delegations. First up, we have Council Orlico from the River Heights for Gary Ward to be heard with respect to COVID-19 Economic Response and Recovery Plan Framework, and that's report one.
So we do that before we do the other registered delegates?
Yeah, Council Orlico will go first, and then we have two more delegations, and then we'll move into reports.
Council Orlico, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm going to be trying to help councillors out as we have so much on our agendas right now, I understand. So I'm just going to give you a quick overview of the $90 million COVID response and recovery proposal and just some of the highlights there. And then maybe next and tell you what the next steps are and kind of why this is on the agenda today. So the first reason it's on the agenda today, it's council motion to have the community committees review the report and also provide input the first time and then come back to provide further input. And this would then go up towards EBC for final kind of collaboration and integration of the different comments community committees will make. And then that would eventually get to council for a final vote. So just the highlights on the plan. Right now there's a it's kind of based upon two tranches, which would be tax incremental financing and use of the Canadian Canada Community Building Fund, formerly known the gas tax. So we have just a high level there's $50 million for affordable housing in TIF, and that's $20 million for downtown, and then $30 million anywhere else outside of downtown. And then there's another one, TIF, for $20 million for business development. Again, that's split evenly between downtown, $10 million for downtown and $10 million for outside of downtown. And then there's $20 million in cash for the Canada Community Building Fund. Again, the old gas tax. And again, $10 million for downtown and then $10 million for outside of downtown. I provided a list, you know, the report is pretty extensive and has a lot of background data and justifications and rationales, but I had sent it, and if anybody needs to resend it, I'm more than happy to. More of a Coles Notes version of the plan, which are really the initiatives that are listed in there, both for downtown and for citywide. Kind of broken down the economic side, broken it down to economics, and then we'll talk maybe equity issues. So that's all available if you need to look at that. Some of the highlights in, you know, some of the highlights in there are some of the initiatives we're already doing. We're just going to really focus on them a bit more. They got brought to the forefront. And then some of the other areas that councillors who I've met with a few councillors already and they've expressed interest, might be shocking to you all, expressed interest in the $10 million gas tax, where that money is going to go and what type of projects would be for TIF. And I'll leave that to Mr. Dryberg and Kathleen later on when they speak to the report. They'll give you a little more details on that. And just finally to say it has been quite a collaborative approach. I've talked to Center Venture, the Biz, both the Winnipeg Chamber and the Downtown Biz, and Heavy Construction and a few other groups. There's generally quite a bit of support for it, and I think that's in due course from the work that Mr. Dryberg has done reaching out to these groups in the past. And now it's laid upon you to look it over. And then if you have any recommendations that you want EPC to look at, this is an ideal time to put those forward. So I'm here to answer any little questions, big questions, whatever I can. Whatever I can't answer, I'll defer it off to the administration when the report comes up in your agenda. And that's about it. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Schreier, Councillor Brouwer, any questions for Councillor Orlico?
Well, I want to thank Councillor Orlico for giving us his overview. I can't think of anything at the moment, having said that, because I know that this is sort of telegraphing the fact that this is going to be a greater part of our lives for the next few weeks anyway, and if not months, and we will have an opportunity for further questions when this agenda item, in fact, comes up during the report items.
Yeah, Councillor Orlico, you indicated now is the most ideal time to bring forward recommendations of changes or stuff like that. The challenge is we've had this report for 4 business days as a community committee. We were first up to get it. I do appreciate you taking the time to meet with me on this. It is a high-level plan. It's a referral, for the most part, to the budget. There is requirements of some of these items for matching dollars federally and provincially. Can you tell us where that's at with matching dollars?
No, I can't. I know both the minister, the federal government and the provincial government are aware of the plan. They were provided when it got released directly, and they were aware of it at the beginning. So I don't believe they have commitments at this point. We're still going to have to develop the TIF policy, a little more detailed oriented, but they are aware of it. They are generally supportive of it. And the question is, will they be supporting by matching dollars in regards to the TIF? But I don't have any information on that today.
So outside of downtown, which I can understand that many of these organizations that you mentioned earlier would be very excited about committed dollars, including the Heavy Construction Association. Can you tell us, so we can inform residents in perhaps Transcona, what's in it for them?
Well, again, we're all part of Winnipeg, so it's not a parochial kind of plan here, but what's in it for the general population? There's many ways that this, well, again, economic recovery is good for all, regardless if you live downtown or if you work downtown. So that's really important. We also know that if our downtown struggles and that tax base disappears, that has a direct impact on taxpayers outside of downtown as well. But there's also things that are quite germane here, which would be, for example, the increase in small business tax credit threshold. Again, that's for all small businesses, downtown or not. Temporary patio program, again, that's going to be going to 222. Waiving some permit fees for street closures, that's again citywide. Working on trying to get some of that permit services going a little bit quicker by reinvesting some funds, that's again citywide. The community center modeling there, where it's waiving, one of the main there is waiving the 50% matching funding requirement for projects. Again, that's citywide. I believe probably every councillor has some community center project that's on the plan. Investing in our parks, our regional parks. So not every councillor has a regional park. Some, like for myself, But again, we did see the impact on regional parks. Again, those are outside downtown. So I believe most councillors may have a touch of a regional park, but then there's also spray pads. Again, that's outside of downtown. It could be inside downtown. Some AT work, that's really looking at this of connectivity, where we saw some gaps that could possibly be shored up. And then there's many other items that are outside of downtown that would apply for the citywide. So I can't say what your projects are in Transcona or what your what Transconians need and what they're looking forward to. They, by all means, the list there is quite extensive. So you could probably just highlight things that you know from your works that would be of interest for your residents as well.
So I believe there was reference to the Airport Westlands investing in servicing those. Is there a reason, am I accurate on that for the first point?
Where was I just saw it? Yes, the answer quickly is accelerated servicing of Airport Area West by using additional one-time funding from the Canada Community Building Fund / gas tax, number 18, yes.
Okay, I see accelerate the servicing Airport West. That's Airport Area West is all I see the reference point. Now, is that the City of Winnipeg undertaking that servicing or the developers of said land that would benefit from unlocking those lands?
Well, it just says to accelerate. So if it's the City of Winnipeg investing, we may be partnering, maybe using some of the federal money. We may be able to partner with the province as well through their some of their programs as well. We always like to have partners when we're investing, but we know from our employment land study that we're losing business by not having service industrial lands that are ready to go. People are flying over Winnipeg and we just don't have it available. They're not stopping to look at investing in Winnipeg. So that's again an area, while it may be in the Airport Area West, it'll create jobs for all Winnipeggers. So it's and a tax base that we can all benefit from. So that's it's already been identified. The Airport Area West is one of our major opportunities to be able to provide that service industrial lands. We do know the problem is the water and this big rock that's in the way, but I know there's lots of work and there'll have to be a report coming forward on what that cost would be and who's partnering with us on it.
So from a sewage capacity, do you know what the estimated impact for unlocking these lands would be?
On the sewage capacity? No, I do not. I just know we're very concerned about the fact, we all are, about the fact that our sewage capacity is reaching to a level that's quite dangerous, where we won't be able to do any more development. That pulse plant just became active recently, so it'll be interesting to see the discharge that's coming out of that. But again, it's we really do hope the province will move forward to be able to support us on our biosolids, so Winnipeg can continue to grow and develop. And but at this point, there's quite a bit of concern about the capacity issues. Unfortunately, the capacity issues will probably hit before the servicing issues get dealt with. So we're really hoping that the province will come forward a little quicker, much quicker than they have, to get that biosolids moving, because it's really important for Winnipeg and East St. Paul and Rosser to be able to continue to attract business. We need to be able to have a place that we can, manage our biosolids.
Well, East St. Paul has their own waste management system.
West St. Paul.
Thank you. You mentioned the pulse plant. Just to clarify, that is not in the City of Winnipeg. That's in the RM of Rosser in the Centerport correct. Lands.
That is correct. And it's also part of our servicing agreement with them that we have with Rosser. And so the tax base is going to Rosser, but we have an agreement with Rosser on a service agreement that allows them to transfer their biosolids to Winnipeg.
And just to clarify, and you probably, I'll do a did you know there's no capacity limits imposed on RM of Rosser with regards to their sewage?
There's no capacity. The agreements that were made back in the previous day don't have capacity limits. It was something that wasn't contemplated at the time. So that's also for East St. Paul and Springfield. We have, well, Springfield has one. They have a
They have the capacity limit at Springfield, but yes, you're absolutely correct. That is negotiations and discussions are continuing with them. I've heard through PP&D and through Water and Waste to see, what are they up to and how much capacity are they looking in the future. It is a first serve, first come program. It's not, you can't book your capacity and then build 10 years later. So it's a concern for all partners right now, because how do you attract business when you're not sure if you're gonna have the sewer capacity?
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Schreier.
Well, on that, and thanks, Councillor Nason, for line of questioning. I do recall last year, Councillor Orlico in council chamber, he mentioned the word unfortunately. We voted on this, was it about a year ago, Councillor Orlico? But you did raise these concerns, as you do today, in terms of the potential dilemmas as you saw it with Rosser, given our agreement regarding biosolids. So fair enough. I took heed of your words when we voted on part of this. It was part of a grander strategy, I think, partly imposed by the provincial government. Does that make sense? Regarding how we are going to work with the adjacent municipalities. Nonetheless, Councillor Orlico, you didn't mention this wisely. So having said that, you did say the agreement's not clear enough. If you could, in terms of your own comfort, in terms of how things may evolve, does it look like there will be at one point, what are you looking for? Because this isn't the first time you've mentioned your concerns about this. What are you hoping for since you've mentioned it regarding an agreement with Ross and the biosolids? You're not the only one concerned, but you raised the concerns first, I think, in terms of my ears. Do you have anything more to say about that?
I personally, if we want to have the debate about that or discussion about that, it's a different subject. I'm here really today to talk about the recovery plan.
Okay, fair enough. But you did again raise your concerns about that, and I don't blame you. But we'll leave it at that for today. Okay, fair enough.
See no concerns from any of my other colleagues. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care.
Our next delegation is Mike Demaray to be heard with respect to the non-conforming approach at 680 Knowles Avenue, and that's report 5. And he'll be joining us remotely. Mike, if you can just turn on your video and unmute yourself, and you have 10 minutes to address
the video. Okay, can you hear me there?
Yes, you have 10 minutes on the clock starting now.
Okay, so I'm requesting a variance for to widen my approach to my property. Just like wrote in my request on the paper there, I have a double wide property, 120 feet wide. I'm currently in the process of making a triple car garage, and I got permits for it, and I started the process as well. I'm requesting a widened driveway, and also secondary to that, I'm requesting I have a ditch. I'm in the north end there of a North Lodge and the Knolls. And I have a ditch property where there's a drain in the middle of my ditch on my property, and I have an extremely deep ditch where it's over 6 feet deep. And I just bought this property last July, and I'm trying to find a way to make it more safe. My street is a very narrow street. It's that temporary asphalt kind of street. It's a very rounded street with no shoulders. And I have two younger kids as well. And when we bike on this street, and it's a very busy street for some reason, also we're doing also a there's a study going on right now to determine how busy, but no, it's a very busy street, and the kids have to drive very close to the shoulder, which there is none. And last July, we had a kid actually fall into my ditch, and my ditch breaks the bylaw in itself, where on the city side there, right off the street, it's a one-to-one slope, which is an extremely deep slope. And last July, when I just moved in, I actually had a kid fall in his ditch. Fortunately, not really hurt, but it really got me thinking, going, why is my ditch so deep and so dangerous? And I drove around the area, and I've got the deepest ditch that I've ever seen and the steepest ditch, where on my property it's actually a 4-to-1 slope, but on the street side it's a 1-to-1 slope, so extremely deep. So I started doing some requesting and stuff to see if I could at least get this filled in, and realizing obviously if I get my ditch filled in, everybody wants their ditch filled in, and I understand that process, but unfortunately, my situation is very different, where it's such a deep ditch, and there's so much, such a dangerous ditch, where you fall in and you're going to get severely hurt with it, that the depth of the ditch is. So my initial request is I want to have this ditch filled in. And obviously there's a drain in the middle of this ditch, making it a little more complicated. But nonetheless, it's a matter of doing a riser on there and filling it properly with culverts and in that one section at least. All the other sections are well less than 6 feet. They're between anywhere from 1 foot to 4 feet deep. And mine drops down to 6 feet with that extreme slope. So secondary, if that request is denied as far as filling in that whole ditch, my request was to extend my culvert, which would allow me to do more of a gradual slope, at least on my driveway side, and not make it quite so steep there as well. Once again, a 4-to-1 slope on my driveway would involve almost a 24-foot horizontal to make it comply with the code, a 4-to-1 ratio of a slope. So again, I don't know how I can comply with the bylaw when there's no room for that. So my initial request was to widen my approach and fill in that ditch for the safety purposes. Secondary, if I can't, at least to extend my approach so I could at least have a more gradual slope. Along with that as well, in the area, it wouldn't be an eyesore. There's numerous properties in my area that have these widened approaches. Right across the street from me, he's got not only a widened approach, but he actually has a secondary driveway too. I'm assuming it's all permitted. It looks like it's appropriate. But also when you drive over the whole neighborhood, there's numerous areas. So it wouldn't be an eyesore. It wouldn't be something that's out of the ordinary in this area. Also along with a double wide property there, because I am having this triple car garage, it would make it more, it make it easier for me to get in and out of my property by even turning around in my driveway so I can drive out of my driveway instead of having to back onto, again, this narrow, busy street. So making it also a little bit safer for not only myself as well and for the people driving by. So yeah, so my request is to obviously prefer to have that ditch filled in and for the safety reasons. And along with that, having a wider approach for my property for the benefit of myself and also for the safety of not only my children, but again, for the numerous children and the people that are walking on this street. Now, that's all I have to say.
Councilor Barwadi.
Thank you very much for your presentation this morning, Mike. Have you reviewed the public service report that recommends approval of the proposed 12 meter? Of the approach. Yes. So the map 12 meter approach. Were you aware that the public service recommended approval of the 12 meter approach? Mike, can you hear me?
Okay, say that again.
Are you aware that the public service prepared a report that recommends approval of the 12 meter approach?
I'm not aware of this.
Okay. Yeah, no, there's the council decision-making information system is a system where members of council and the public receive reports with recommendations from our city employees. This one in particular is authored by Brad Miernick. He's a professional engineer. Even though it's, you know, beyond the standard maximum 6.5 meter wide approach, because of the circumstances there, they are recommending that approach. They have no concerns with the proposed non-conforming approach. So their recommendation is to support it. In terms of the depth of your ditch, I'm not intimately familiar with the area. The way drainage ditches work is, you know, they flow into other pipes and that, and, you know, water doesn't move uphill. The idea is the water is to be moved away from people's properties and into sewers eventually, and into Buns Creek in that case, in some cases in the area, and eventually away. It's not ornamental, it's actually to move standing water and, you know, runoff water from people's properties. Were you aware of that?
Yes, I am a contractor for 35 years. I've done landscaping for numerous years as well, so I'm also involved in those things. So yeah, I'm definitely well aware of how that system should work and does work. I'm also well of a solution of how to make this work appropriately so that you'd still maintain a slope on the property as well, and still accomplish having a safer ditch by filling it with culvert and a drain system.
Okay. Again, we'll be dealing with this item in a couple minutes, but after that, I would suggest maybe getting in contact with my office jbrawati@winnipeg.ca. We can get you in contact with the land drainage person for the area. I think it might be David Shaw. And we can see if there's anything that can be done to the ditch to perhaps address some of those issues there. Again, I welcome you to the neighborhood. I think you have to appreciate that, in terms of your kids and their safety, there wasn't sidewalks there when you moved in. There is a process to upgrade your street to a full range of municipal services, including a paved roadway, ornamental street lighting, paved surfaces, and land drainage sewers, and that's through local improvement. You can find that on the City of Winnipeg's website as well. And the way that works is you can either pay an upfront cost to have that upgraded, or you can pay on your property tax bill over a number of years. You need to get a petition signed by a number of your neighbors. The cost is fairly significant, but it does, provide those additional amenities if that's something, that's of a concern to you and your neighbors. So I encourage you to look at that process.
Okay, I'll email you. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
So question I have for you, Michael, and I looked at the report. So you're adding another garage to this property?
Yes. So right now there's the two cars attached, and I'm adding one more 17-foot garage right now. I have a permanent place and it's in progress.
Oh, so you've already got the permit for that, but just the driveway is just helping give more room for your vehicles to get in and out?
Right, correct.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Nick. Our next delegation is David Benarchek from Stantec to be heard with respect to park plan approval, development agreement 11 of 2013, Devonshire Park Public Reserves A and B, and that's report 4. And David will be joining us remotely as well. Hi, David. All. You have 10 minutes to make your presentation.
Thank you. So I can share a screen if the council or the committee would prefer that. I believe I've circulated the drawings for these two public reserves in Devonshire Park. I'm working with GenStar Development Company to advance these public reserves. As you probably know, Devonshire Park has an advanced level of build out right now. So we're a little bit behind in getting these public reserves in place, but we're doing all we can to get them through.
Go ahead and share your screen, please.
Sure. Okay, so apologize if I look away a little bit here, but just want to confirm you guys can see.
Yes, we can see.
Okay, so the two parks, PRs in question are at the intersection of Transcona Boulevard and Peguis. And you can see here, we call this the corner park. And then there's the Lakeside Park, which is more central to the community. And that's at the headway of Veterans Drive and surrounds this naturalized lake. So starting with, I'll just go through the first few drawings in the set. The rest are kind of grading and detailing, but just to give an overview, this is the corner park. We feel like visitors to the site that are arriving on by bicycle or by foot, this will be sort of the informal entry to the community. It's at that sort of main intersection, and we think that this will basically be the sort of the front of the community for those people. So we are bringing people in on a granular active transportation path through the park. This is sort of a wide open lawn park. We want it to feel open, spacious, safe, inviting. So that's why it's sort of got that open feel to it. We've got a backdrop of aspen planting. The site formerly had some a dense sort of thicket of aspen forest, not great quality, but we want to bring back some of the what was there. So that sort of central seating area in the middle as well is kind of our focal point. It'll be highly visible from the street, and we see that as sort of the gathering or meeting area for people coming in and going. If I sort of zoom into that, so we've got a seating area with benches on both sides of that park. There's a steel canopy shade structure and a lot of shelter for with trees and planting in that area to give a nice sort of a wind sheltered feel, some shade as well. So you'll be able to find a bench on either side. So it's kind of a conversation area. Whether you want to sit in the sun or sit in the shade, you'll have those options. That entire area is being lifted up a little bit. So it's a little bit prominent on the site. It's bermed up, and you'll see these sort of gabion retainers that just help us retain that soil and lift it up. So you basically enter the site and you come up onto a bit of a knoll and then back down into the community. But we want that area to be as visible and prominent as possible. In the rest of the park, basically we're using trees to define and demarcate boundaries. So you have a line of trees on either side of the property here. We want sort of more open, visible permeability, so we're using a wood bollard along those sections, and then we're using trees to mark entry into the site so that it's there's a wayfinding aspect to it. So just going back, the Lakeside Park we're going to look at in two pieces. So this sort of south end has a little play area there, and then the north end, it's really just, this is an amenity space for people who are in the community who want to stroll along that that lakeside, and as well as for the people who are living backing onto it. So this is the south end of the park. You can see that play area featuring prominently behind the roundabout at Veterans Drive. We've made sure that we've given it an adequate setback so that we're looking at safety, and thanks to PP&D for helping us navigate through that. Again, in order, because we have a sloping grassed area, and then with the pond, this is our 7-to-1 slope area. We use a gabion again to retain and get and flatten out this land and allow us to lift up that park a little bit, that play park a little bit, so that it drains better and is more visible. Here's the expanded plan. So you'll see there's a concrete seating area for the parents who are potentially watching their children. They can sit on these benches or have nice long views over this lake. So we're trying to create that kind of lakeside seating node. We've got a play structure that's tailored more to little ones, so 2-to-5s, and then a swing set. PP&D asked us to make sure that there's a play area within 600 meters walking distance of anywhere in the neighborhood, so that's why we've got this one here. And these little blow-ups here just show the actual structures that we're looking at. So we're focusing on a wide range of play activity as well as accessibility for maximum users. So this is the north side of the park. And again, it's a pretty pared down, simple, but what we wanted to do here, because there's a naturalized pond and there'll be native grasses and wetland there, we wanted to provide sort of more amenity space. So this is open lawn so that people living along here can come out their back gate, throw a ball around, as well as the rest of the community. So it's as usable as possible. Our path follows right along that top of 7-to-1. So there's as wide of an area here as possible. This is the connection to George Perone's Way, and we have to do a little bit of creative grading here to get that out. I can mention that as far as how we're draining this park, these lakeside parks can be challenges. So we're using the sort of the latest and greatest city detail of capturing water runoff from the lots in a trench, and then that gets piped to the normal water line of the pond. So every so often you'll have a drop from back here, and the water will flow there. So this park should be fairly high and dry, and will only really deal with the runoff that falls directly on it. So at the top end of the park, we've got a small seating node, a concrete pad here with another gabion retainer, just to make sure that we can flatten this out, given all the slopes, surrounded by planting and another steel canopy shade canopy. We're looking for durability and long lasting. So it'll be a powder coated. It'll be a pre-engineered product that we can get a long lifespan out of. So if there's any questions, maybe I just wanted to give an overview and answer any questions that you guys might have. Let me know.
Okay. I'll start since it's in my ward. Benches look to be sparse on this, on both these park areas, and concentrated in one area. Knowing demographics and what I've experienced in the time that I've been here, there's cultural communities that do not like to sit in the same area between male members of the community and female members of the community. How do you address that in this situation, since you have them all centralized?
We have three separated seating areas. So in each one, there's multiple benches. There's rarely just one, because we're trying to create those conversation spaces. In the past, we have placed benches along pathways. So if that's something that the city would like to see, we can either reallocate. But I feel, to your point, that we'd need at least two so that you can have that kind of conversation. We're always trying to create the best vista, and we're always trying to make sure that we're placing them in areas that are surveillable. So that's always important as well.
I likely will be asking for more, not moving. Garbage receptacles, I noticed on Corner Park, it looks like, and apologies, I'm trying to deal with the computer screen and the print edition, and it's hard to see on either. It looks like on Corner Park, you only have one that's on the northeast corner. Is that accurate?
Let me review that quickly, because that might be correct. Through the city process, we're asked definitely to put them in, and we know that the city wants them to be in, and I know Shauna's on this call, she might be able to speak to this, but we know that they want them to be in areas that are easily accessible for emptying. So that's probably the logic behind where they're placed. Our thought is that as long as one is visible from wherever you are in the park, that it should be adequate. But
trust me, I know from what I hear, there's never enough. And it comes with a cost for collection. I understand that. The gabions, can you tell me? I know it doesn't sound like the one in Corner Park's too much of a height. I am concerned about a gabion adjacent to children's swing sets. Can you articulate where we're at with that height-wise? Because it's at the edge of the water, is it not?
No, that would...
Shoreline?
It's quite a distance from that as well. So just looking here, your shoreline, where your normal water will sit, is down here on this dark dashed line.
Yeah.
There's your sort of your indicators. So that's your normal water level. This is the 14 or so meters of 7-to-1 slope. So that will be have dense grasses in it. It's not in our contract, but it's being done right now, I believe. So that in and of itself is a good demarcation of boundary. Our gabions do not drop more than 2 feet. That's sort of engineering restrictions. So we don't want to have railings or anything there. So that's important that the drop is not considered dangerous in any way. And we want to make sure that everything there is surveillable. So we've got the seating and that. The wire itself, we're not using the twisted wire that you might see in some gabions. We're using an architectural wire, so it's a welded wire, and it's much cleaner. It has no catches, nothing that will grab you the way that they're constructed.
Okay. Are there fountains in this park?
No fountains.
No fountains. Okay. It's been a little while since I've been up there because it's a big body of water in that park. Is it going to be fully naturalized or just segments?
My understanding is everything in that 7-to-1 area gets upland grasses. And everything below there, you'll see benches where the contours pull out. That gets wetland planting. So that's cattail.
All right. I don't know if I can see, but council colleagues, do you have any questions? No, no, see any hands raised? Okay, thank you. Will he need to stay on if we do make changes?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. David, can you just hang out? We'll just in the room.
I sure can. I sure can.
We also, Councillor Nacy, we also have Shauna Prochek on the meeting as well from the public service.
Okay.
Okay.
We do have a hearing to start at
10:30. Yeah.
So I guess we could go into the hearing, start it, and then come back to this.
We could, yep.
Because we don't have a lot of items.
Or we'll have until 10:59 to start the hearing. So it's up to the committee.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. All right. I guess at this point, we can go into reports. So report one. The COVID-19 Economic Response Recovery Plan Framework.
Yes, good morning, councillors. So joining me today to speak to this agenda item are Matt Dryberg, our Senior Manager of Economic Development and Policy, as well as Kate Finsky, the CEO of the Downtown Winnipeg Biz. As you know, in April, council requested the public service create a framework to assist with economic response and recovery. The motion was both broad in its request and yet also had some very specific components. Councillor Orlico has provided an overview and delegation earlier this morning, and now we'll go over some of the more detailed information with you.
If I could just intersect.
Yep.
For the public service, this is a public service presentation.
Yes.
So what is the role of Kate Finsky in this?
I'll turn it over to the CFO to answer that.
Yeah, Kate's joining us, councillor, in case there's any issues with respect to the downtown recovery framework that was attached to our report. Our report aligns closely with the work that their group did.
Again, she's mm-hmm. representing an organization that will benefit greatly from this.
Yes.
So this is not public presentations or representations on this. So is there not a conflict with her being here at this time?
I'm not sure if it's a conflict.
This is a public service presentation.
Correct. That's correct.
She is not a member of the public service.
That's correct.
So to me, it's you, Matt, and whoever else from the public service.
I feel that because she was so instrumental in the creation of this report and the downtown components of it, she should be here, but.
I object to that.
If I may, I am torn right now. I actually appreciate Councillor Nason's point. I guess to this, you know, what are the conventions here? When else is this conventional for such a presentation to a committee of council, be it council itself? Would that have been appropriate? Would there have been no questions of this?
I guess our thinking, councillor, was that, you know, from time to time, consultants are included in presentations or discussions. And so that was our logic in having Ms. Finsky join us this morning.
Her report is also attached as an appendix to our report.
Does Ms. Finsky have a presentation to make this morning as part of this?
Well, she was going to speak to just if there were specific issues on her part of the.
If we make the chair more comfortable, perhaps we could move into delegations again and add Ms. Finsky as a delegation if she wants to make a couple comments. Or
that would be more appropriate.
Okay. Well, let's maybe start with this and we'll move into delegations at the appropriate time.
Okay, sure.
Who's chairing?
Who's chairing the meeting? It's Councillor Nason.
Okay, so do we want to motion then, Councillor Nason, on this?
Councillor Broad, it moves that we continue on with the report of the public service and perhaps
at the appropriate time.
At the appropriate time.
If we so want, we can
move back into delegations.
All right.
So back to the waiting room.
And I support the motion.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Okay. Thank you. So as I was saying, Councillor Orlico provided an overview this morning in delegation, and now we will go through some more information on the report with you. So Council's motion had many components, including reimagining service delivery, a two-year recovery plan, intergovernment engagement, community consultation, a focus on the downtown, options to accelerate employment lands use, and then subsequently, additional components were combined to this report to include community centers and a feasibility analysis of rebating a portion of the accommodations tax out of the Destination Marketing Reserve Fund. You recall that in July, Mr. Dryberg, me, and Ms. Fenske from the Downtown Winnipeg Biz attended this community committee meeting to present some high-level observations on the pandemic impacts to the city. And at that time, we saw it and we received feedback from you, which is included in the report. This framework report is tied to the principles of our Winnipeg, even though a third reading is still outstanding. There are broad components of our city addressed, including business, residents, the downtown, and underserved areas. And to make it easier for readers, the report was combined into one document, because it's very large, but the summary report is the first 20 pages with all the supporting information following. Included in the framework report is a synopsis of the financial situation of the city, including the most recent forecast to the end of the year. So the total dollar impact of the pandemic is clearly in the minds of the readers of this report. And to recap, last year the impact was softened by federal safe restart funds of almost $75 million. This year, those funds are not on the table, and the city's loss from the pandemic is estimated to total over $84 million. That is a significant challenge for council and the public service. There's also an in-depth analysis prepared by the city's team of economists to highlight the pandemic impacts. There's a lot of useful information packed into that analysis, and I encourage you to read it if you get a moment. The public service adapted its service delivery to align with public health orders and with the way our citizens wanted us to provide services to them. So in that section of the report, you'll see several components. What did we do and what will we keep doing? A summary of the work from home impacts, support we've been providing to the province to help with the pandemic response, and then plans for the future service delivery, plus a snapshot of some additional savings. An analysis of the financial situation of community centers is included, along with analysis of the feasibility of providing the rebate to hoteliers of accommodation tax. We've also included a summary of what we heard through the consultation process in two parts. First, you'll find the community committee's input, and second is what we learned from community partners and stakeholders. And given the large number of stakeholders, we didn't have time to talk to everybody, but we did manage to have discussions with 26 organizations, and we are continuing those conversations. The recommendations of the public service align closely to the downtown recovery framework, which is attached as an appendix. There is merit in working together with our community partners on downtown recovery, because a vibrant and successful downtown is beneficial to all the citizens of Winnipeg, as well as to the coffers of the city of Winnipeg. And finally, there is specific information on the acceleration of the servicing of employment lands. And in order to track the success of this framework, some KPIs or measurements of success are suggested. I want to emphasize that the recommendations in the framework report are fiscally prudent, because city financial resources and fiscal levers are limited as a municipality. However, you'll see how they are wide ranging to assist many of our citizens. And the recommendations were organized into four sections. Number one, tax and tax support strategies. Examples include continuing the increase in the business tax exemption threshold, two, increasing the use of the community center renovation grant program, and waiving the temporary patio fees and street closure fees for street parties or entertainment. Those measures will cost the general revenue fund less than $200,000 in lost revenue. The second section is policy considerations, including removing barriers to bidding opportunities through streamlined and improved contract language, and continuing with the equity, diversity, and inclusion policy and strategy focused on employment programs, bridging programs, and department-specific EDI activities aimed to increase the number of underrepresented group members as new employees of the City of Winnipeg. Third section is on service delivery adaptations, such as a focus on the ease of doing business with the city and red tape reduction. And finally, there's a section on collaboration and advocacy. And in here, we've emphasized the collaboration with the Downtown Winnipeg Biz on its specific short-term plans to kickstart downtown economic recovery. The Downtown Recovery Framework was released last week, and we've leveraged the city's report to align with that strategy. As I just noted, the requested support from the operating budget is less than $200,000. And I'll ask Mr. Dryberg to speak to the recommendations for capital expenditures and the use of tax increment financing.
Thanks. Thanks, Catherine. And thanks for having me here today. The plan itself calls for an investment of $20 million from Winnipeg's share of the additional federal gas tax funding, which is now called the Canada Community Building Fund. That $20 million of proposed investment includes $10 million invested in downtown projects, projects that are aligned with the downtown recovery strategy, as well as a further $10 million to be invested, or proposed to be invested rather, in regional parks, active transportation projects, and splash pads, with specific projects to be determined. The other significant aspect of the recovery plan is a proposal to use tax increment financing to help incentivize certain developments. Tax increment financing, or TIF, is essentially grants from incremental property taxes that are generated by new development. And the plan here proposes to allocate up to $50 million of incremental property tax grants to support the development of new affordable housing, including $20 million in the downtown and $30 million in other areas of the city. The plan also includes a proposal to use a further $20 million of TIF to support the development of businesses, as well as other mixed use and commercial investment, driven primarily by the private sector. And here the proposal is to allocate $10 million of TIF within the downtown and $10 million of TIF for these projects in other areas of the city. If this is ultimately acceptable to council, the public service would then return with a report in March of 2022 that would provide a more comprehensive tax increment financing policy for council's consideration, or to implement the TIF support contained in the plan. So the total proposed city investments in this plan from both the gas tax and the TIF is $90 million. That's a big number, but it's important to note the majority of that support is through TIF, which would essentially be provided through grants for eligible developments over a number of years. So the budget impact of this initially would be quite minimal. Overall, the measures that are contained in the plan are intended to provide Winnipeg with a foundation for economic recovery. I think it was referenced earlier on in some of the delegations that the hope is also to use this as a plan to work with other levels of government to leverage support to help advance Winnipeg's economic recovery post-pandemic. So I guess with that, I'll leave it there and entertain questions from anybody.
Colleagues, questions? Councillor Schreier, none? Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry, thank you, Chair Nason. No, I have no questions at this time. I just have a comment to make at the end when we vote, if I may.
Mr. Dryberg, can you direct me to where regional parks are notated?
In the plan?
Or outlined as to what you define as regional parks?
I think there are about 12 of them in total. I don't have the list in front of me, but I can get those to you if you'd like.
Yeah, it goes to the $10 million, and you indicated basically determined at a later date. Can you articulate how and by whom?
Well, I mean, one option would be if folks have ideas here today, those recommendations could go towards EPC for and ultimately council for their consideration. I think what we would probably do as a public service is we would definitely want to work with closely with council and committees to generate a list of projects that could fit the criteria of regional parks, as well as AT and splash pads. the idea would be council would ultimately be supreme in terms of what projects are selected.
So basically wait until all the money's used up and then we have an opportunity. Okay. The TIF policy that you articulated won't be coming back till March 2022?
That's the recommendation. I think we still have some work to do, consultations with some stakeholders to make sure that we get it right. I think that the project categories that I've referenced here would be part of that policy. We do have some work to do in terms of what the TIF duration and what projects would be eligible and which projects wouldn't be eligible for TIF. But certainly that policy would then come before council
for a decision. But adoption of this is basically giving 50% of your TIF policy money away without a policy, is it not?
Well, this would outline some of the main categories that we would offer up for consideration in that policy. And if these were ultimately acceptable to council, then we would design the TIF policy around these broad categories.
So it's the typical council supreme, and regardless if we have a policy or not, we can Absolutely. Do whatever we want.
Absolutely.
That makes sense, of cart before the horse. Okay. I obviously didn't come prepared with formal motions today. Colleagues, do you have anything further? This would be your time, Councillor Schreier.
Yeah, thank you. Councillor Orlico did mention in terms of this plan and its presentation today, given that the administration was here to answer questions, he did talk about community centers, spray pads that are local to our wards, or at least our community committee, our region of the city. Do we have any comments to this local community committee regarding Councillor Orlico's comments on that, on this report as it's presented here locally?
So, Councillor, we were directing the recommendations on community centers to all of the wards, nothing specific to this particular group of wards. Mm-hmm. The recommendations were talking about loosening up the eligibility requirements for those community center renovation grant programs. So that could be for any community center. And then continuing on with supporting those that need help with their operating and debt grants. So, and then the spots are in all sorts of places, right? I recall there is a report on splash pad strategy. And so that would be aligned to this recommendation.
What type of facilitating of regulations or streamlining of regulations are we talking about? I don't necessarily feel good about that. It might be a good thing. It can be sometimes. I'm assuming we've been dealing with that for years, not just now. What type of facilitation are we talking about?
Yeah, I think there's a number of things we've been considering. So I'll give you a simple example of how it's not necessarily easy to do business sometimes for residents. You know, if you're trying to register for a program, we don't have a fillable PDF form online. People have to print it, fill it out by hand, fax it back. And then if you want refunds, sometimes there's mail involved. So we're trying to find ways to use technology to make it easier for our citizens to do business. And with respect to red tape reduction, I know, for example, the Planning, Property and Development Group is continuing to try and make strides to streamline the permitting and inspection process, using online tools where we can. So those are just a couple of examples.
Okay. How does it, would there be any detraction from accountability through a community committee? Would there be any changes to that, or any accountability in terms of, in the streamlining, will it take away from accountability in terms of how we go about making the decisions for these contract allocations?
So if you're speaking specifically to the decisions made by this community committee, you know, as the CFO, one of my goals is always to make sure there's adequate internal controls and controls over expenditures, and the decisions are made in accordance with policy. So I wouldn't foresee any changes to those accountability structures, if I'm answering your question.
Fair enough. And that's fine. Thank you.
I will state, I don't know if I need to do this as a motion from a regional parks perspective. I would very much like to see an allocation of $500,000 towards Bueller Park to support an upcoming major sport event in 2023 that they may be party to. I did share that with Councillor Orlico and Councillor Gillingham. I'd also like to see some of the disconnects of AT that are in Transcona completed. We've got short stretches that would benefit greatly from a completion of our network through this activity. We've gone down the rabbit hole quite heavily, it looks like, in the downtown area. I don't see a plan A, plan B, plan C approach. Plan B, province in partnership or not in partnership. You know, there's the ask for them to be there for matching, but what if? What if we continue in a protracted situation of downtown not coming back? What if we find that the changes to our local economy, not just downtown, continue to suffer from the lack of a workforce? That's the number one thing I'm hearing. I'm hearing inflationary price pressures coming to the forefront. When we have 4+% inflation, what is that impact going to be? What happens if interest rates continue to climb? What if the artificially contained inflation or interest rates? Sorry, Tamara, I know you're trying to capture what I'm saying. I'm worried about inflationary and interest rates, that they're going to have some devastating effects to our economy. But we're not talking about that. We're adding debt at incredible rates, municipally, provincially, federally. At some point, the bill's coming due. And, you know, my kids will suffer, but I think my kids' kids and so on are going to be suffering even further. We got a $1 trillion deficit at the federal level, or projected to go. You know, they're spending recklessly without any sort of controls. So at what point do we talk about those things from an economic lens?
Good question.
Is that a question?
That's a question, because I don't see that reflected in the report of significant changes, impact on labor availability, impact on interest rates, impact on inflation. Where are they factored into your report? Did I miss it?
Well, I mean, inflation's always is always a concern. We have to be cognizant of that in whatever we do. As far as interest rates are, I mean, at this time there, and Catherine can speak probably more to that than I can, where our borrowing rates are fairly good, and we have the ability to lock in at affordable rates. The larger questions you raise about inflation and whatnot are important ones for sure. I'm not sure as a municipality what we can do to deal with that. I mean, monetary policy, as you know, is within federal jurisdiction. So our levers here are limited. The intent in crafting this plan was to try and maximize the levers that we have to support a foundation for economic recovery and to hopefully lead and leverage greater financial support from other levels of government that have access to more levers and more revenue streams.
Well, if I may retort, everybody's got their hand out looking for handouts. Mm-hmm. So I understand wanting to lead and trying to pick the pockets first. I appreciate that, but this is a 2-year economic and recovery plan with a primary focus on downtown, and I can appreciate that. But to say that we can't be physically or financially conservative in our approach, like, is this draining our reserves further outside of what's going to be proposed to drain our reserves as part of balancing our books? Because last year our books were balanced primarily from federal and provincial coffers and bonus money that we got of the former gas tax.
I think overall the plan is a pretty fiscally prudent approach. Catherine's probably better positioned to speak to that than I am.
Yeah, so if you look at the most recent forecast, Councillor, we still have excess capacity above the threshold in the financial stabilization reserve, but you're right. It has been a challenging year. Next year, the year after budget, our challenge at this point to work through. The goal is always to balance, and that will be what comes before council. We can't really do anything other than that. This particular report, we tried to find ways to do things that weren't adding extra burden on taxpayers. So as I suggested, the two items that hit the operating fund for the general revenue fund are less than $200,000 in total cost. And then the other expenditures of the one-time top-up of the Canada Community Building Fund doesn't really impact the operating and general revenue fund as well. So we've tried to find ways to leverage what we have. And as Matt was talking about, the tax increment financing is over a very long period of time, say 25 years. So it's not impacting the next couple of years' budget. And you had mentioned that we've got a debt issue. We didn't issue any debt this year. We were able to get by without issuing debt. We may issue some next year. It really depends on liquidity needs. Interest rates are very low and continue to stay low. And I think it's been prudent of this council to have the debt management strategy and the financial management strategy where we have those thresholds that keep us in check. And we still have some capacity there. So I think you've been prudent in what you've done over the last few years with that strategy of keeping a lid on the debt. So we need to keep that in mind for affordability.
How much external debt does the city of Winnipeg currently have?
At the top of my head, I can't remember the number, Councillor, but I know there's still capacity within our model to borrow additional amounts.
Oh, yeah. Council, of course, can always raise the ceiling.
Well, I'm talking within that threshold.
Yeah. Would it be accurate that it's somewhere in the range of $1.3 to $1.6 billion?
Something like that, yeah. It's around.
What is the interest rates on that?
It varies from time to time, but right now rates are quite low. So you can issue debt at like 3.5% right now. It's pretty low if you're doing long-term financing. As the Bank of Canada continues to keep those targets low in terms of inflation at 2%, I think we're going to see those rates stay down. I know inflation right now is spiking, but the long-term forecasts still show it coming back in at around 2. So it's where everyone's assuming for now, the economists, that it's a bit of a spike to make up for what happened in the previous 18 months.
I certainly remember 16%+ interest rates and people that are, you know, less than a paycheck away from being homeless.
Yep.
It's a very scary time right now.
Yep.
You know, people are making hard and fast choices of food on the table, mm-hmm. medicines that they need. And some of the people that be impacted by the decisions that we make of, we have a 2.33% tax increase that under this administration has been done year over year, which compounds. We have frontage fees. We have water and sewer rates that continue to climb. We have public transit that's now, regular transit fare, one-time fare is over $3. We have transit that's running at 50% capacity, mm-hmm. so they say. I don't know about my colleagues, but day in and day out, I see lots of empty buses. It's seldom that I see a bus like the old days, 19 or before, where it's jammed to the hilt. Mm-hmm. Maybe on some of the primary lines, but for the most part, sure. I see two or three people. I don't know, maybe it's my fault, and this is more of a diatribe than anything, but I don't see some of the plans that we had early on, some of the triggers, if you will. If it goes from 0 to 6 months, this is what we're doing. 6 to 12, this is what we're doing. Haven't seen that since the early days of COVID, well before your time, Catherine. And I maybe that's why I'm uncomfortable. I, I see a report that's got 19 pages, 20 pages, whatever it might be, items that are appendices that aren't listed as appendices. It's a lot of stuff, but it's not a menu or a suite that's easily to navigate. I see Transcona Biz is referenced in there as one of the stakeholders that I believe was consulted. I'm on the board of the Transcona Biz, and you know, I'm going to be reaching out after this meeting to find out from the chair and from the executive director the extent of consultation, so I can understand more appreciatively what they were presented with from a perspective of economic recovery for outside of downtown. This is a very focused downtown plan, right? A lot of the clarity is downtown. The rest of it is we'll make it up as we go or as council decides. So I've articulated a couple of things. I don't know, Tamara, how that goes forward from here, if we need to vote on it or if my colleagues have additional things they want to have included.
Do you have specific recommendations you want to make?
I took some down. So we do have to report something back to EPC, whether we concur in the recommendation of the public service, if we concur with the following amendments, we could add those issues that you brought up, not concur in the public service, or we can request for a layover. But again, everything has to go to EPC. We have to report something back to EPC.
Yeah.
Or today.
Well, I can easily put dollar values into the AT undertaking. So.
Sorry, Councilor Nason, what I took down, in addition to your following amendments, you wanted to allocate $500,000 to Buehler Park, complete the disconnects of active transportation in Transcona, and address the impact on labor availability, interest rates, and inflation. That's what I gathered.
Sure.
In that conversation. Did I miss anything?
No, I think that works for me for now. If there's further amendments, we can look at it at EPC or.
And yeah, this would be the recommendation to EPC.
Colleagues, do you have anything further?
Again, I just have a comment to make after the motion's made or before the vote.
No,
I can't move the motion as chair at the moment. So, Councilor Barwadi, you take the chair.
I still want to maybe make a couple more comments. We'll
absolutely
have a group motion. I want to see what this motion will look like before we. I don't know. This is so nebulous and moving. Again, we're talking about, you just say that the pandemic has absolutely had an impact on many aspects of people's lives. I mean, the last 18, 20 months have been unprecedented in, you know, all of our lives. Different, you know, I know I heard Councillor Schreier, you know, mentioned on the radio on Sunday morning on the Clay Young show that we're all in this together. But the reality is, I mean, many Winnipeggers have been impacted differently by this. When it comes to the health of our economy and our businesses, the downtown has been impacted worse than the suburbs. You go drive down Regent Avenue on a Thursday afternoon, the place is hopping. There's traffic everywhere. The stores, the Costco's, the grocery stores, their Home Depot's of the world are wild. Our downtown is suffering. You go through Winnipeg Square, the concourse at lunchtime, it's nothing like it was. We have, you know, all sorts of boarded up businesses downtown. The reality is, I mean, downtown Winnipeg is less than 1% of the physical footprint of Winnipeg, but it generates approximately 20% of all commercial property taxes and 12% of our city's tax base. Over 70% of office space is located in the downtown area. That's what's changed. That's why we need to have a plan. That's why it makes sense for us to look at ways to try and simulate that and bring it back. Downtown Winnipeg is never going to be the commercial retail hub of Winnipeg again. Winnipeg's changed. If you're downtown Winnipeg, you have to be different. It's going to be our recreational amenities, having Canada Life's place, or Canada Life Center. It's no longer a place, it's a center, Canada Life Center. Having the arts and entertainment, having medical facilities, having those office complexes. That's not unusual for North American cores to see the retail move out. So what are we looking at? We're looking at TIFs. to support housing in our downtown core. Again, I get a little bit antsy. My personal belief is that, you know, when it comes to housing initiatives, that is not a municipal responsibility when it comes to subsidized housing in our province. But making sure we have a healthy downtown is. The fact that, you know, doing development downtown is. Doing things like finding improved permitting processes to redevelop some of our spaces to be housing, I think is a good initiative. You know, there should be, you know, improved processes. At the same time, I recognize that, you know, hardworking Winnipeggers, housing is probably their biggest cost, their biggest assets when it comes to their homes. If we give breaks across the board, you know, if we give tons of breaks downtown, effectively, it's going to cost people in the burbs. So they have to be smart. They have to be thoughtful. They have to be fair. So, I mean, in general, I support the overall development plan. If Councillor Nason is already putting on the floor particular projects when it comes to sort of the recreational improvements, I want to see more contributed to our region's quadrant park, that being Glacona Park. In September 2014, Council adopted the Strategic Renewal and Action Plan for Glacona Park. Rather than, you know, skip the queue and try to move money as fast as possible, even though the public, you know, had seen this plan, I did the way you were supposed to do it. I put it in, you know, year five of the budget. The first tranche to implement that first phase is $6 million. I'd like to see that phase have a meaningful start in the next couple of years. I'd like to see perhaps some of that regional park money go onto it. Unlike, you know, a little piece of bike lane or something, this is our region's park. This is more than
Bueller is
sorry,
also
quadrant park, the big four. This is a high a level up from a regional park even. So, anyways, that'll be my addition to the recommendation is a substantial contribution towards the first phase, or another contribution towards the first phase of the strategic renewal and action plan for Glacona Park.
We're almost on the time that we need to get started.
Sure, I'll move that. I'll move that we suspend the regular meeting and open the public hearing.
Okay, motion's been heard. All in favor?
Aye. I move that we suspend the public hearing and move back into our regular meeting.
Okay. Motion's been heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Carry.
For those in the audience, I'm going to propose that after we deal with this one item, the economic plan, we then do a public hearing and suspend the regular agenda at that point.
Oh, you moved that? Sorry.
It was sort of a commentary. I mean, does that, and just for people's time, do my colleagues support that notion?
Mm-hmm.
Just so people can judge their time. I know people's time is precious here. Okay, thank
you. The motion is to bring it back to the regular meeting, and that's what the
just
motion
to finish number one.
Finish item one.
The idea is after item one, we'll go into the hearing right away.
Okay. Sure. I'm just ready to speak when the motion is moved on item one.
I'm waiting to hear the final motion too. Do you have anything to add to the motion?
No, I don't.
Okay, then.
No Louise Bridge motion?
That is, I'll confer as well with Jim Malloway on that before I bring anything further and get some.
Further, the counselor, my good colleague from North Kildonan, Councillor Berwati, we who are not part of EPC are fighting for the scraps that fall off the table. And yes, you've got a super park of Kilcona, Harborview, that is falling, Harborview particularly, that's falling into the state of decay. That's not a good look for the city of Winnipeg. You can't simply stick some paint on it and hope for the best. It's slowly slipping into the retention pond that it's adjacent to. Yes, it's a former garbage dump, but it's still a regional park, and Kilcona in particular is a well-used portion of it. The harbor view side is less so, but with some love, it is important to East Kildonan, Transcona, and North Kildonan where it resides. So I'd support your amendment. Okay, are you wanting to move it or?
Sure, I want to hear the final.
Let me make sure. Okay, so we're still, is the idea the initial though to concur in the recommendation of the public service, but with the following amendments? Is that, Counselor Nason, was that your original motion?
Yeah, I'll go with that.
Okay, to include the following in the economic response and recovery plan. A, allocate $500,000 to Beeler Park. B, complete the disconnects of active transportation in Transcona. Address the impact on labor availability, interest rates, and inflation, and funding for substantial construction for the first phase strategic renewal action plan for Kildonan Park.
I'll be strategic action plan.
For the what?
Sure, yes. I'll move that.
Okay, motion's been heard. Okay, oh, Counselor Schreier?
Sure, discussion.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I do really appreciate the questions and comments by my fellow counselors, including Counselor Orlico this morning. You know, I don't find what we're saying essentially that contradictory to each other. When you put it together, you get a greater concept of what's going on. Counselor Broady, your comments about our downtown, you know, and the specific challenges we have, I agree. I would add to that, that's been our constant challenge for decades. If you consider, you know, in the 1980s, dealing with the North Portage project in the first place, and then in the 90s and the O's, dealing with the downtown hockey arena and things like this. So yes, that challenge continues, Council Broady, and yes, during COVID, it's put some special pressures on maintaining the viability of our downtown and how it evolves, Councilor Broady, and thank you for that. Councilor Nason, your comments on a word in response to you was the word fiscal prudence. Look, this is what I've been talking about since I got elected. Thank you, Councilor Nason, for bringing your insights into how we maintain a sense of fiscal prudence and accountability to the taxpayer. It's incredibly important. I'm going to say something here. This package, we say it's due to COVID, but I'm going to make the point that if you look throughout the last number of years and decades, within our lifetime, our adult lifetime, essentially everybody here in this chamber, that we're already approaching an era of critical mass in terms of real concerns about what's sustainable in our economic system. Councillor Nason, you challenged the system with your questions today. I don't know what we can do in terms of this report at this community committee or in the short term when we're trying to deal with short term with COVID, but the questions you ask are systemic, they're long term. These are questions we should have been getting answers to over decades, the last few decades. COVID is just sort of almost like speeding it up, but it's not actually changing the problems. They're just speeding up. These problems are happening. My concern is the only era where we show no fiscal prudence when we're trying to cut back here and cut back there is in the one that actually causes the greatest constraints, the greatest pressures on our budget year after year, decade and decade. And that is what is a non-public service aspect of our expenditure. And that is the construction contracts. And there is nothing in here that shows greater fiscal prudence in the construction contracts. I don't expect it to. I don't expect that in this document. So I'm going to vote for the document. But having said that, it raises these concerns because it says we're doing this in the name of fiscal prudence. But the greatest area where we show year and after decades where the lack of prudence is shown to be the greatest inflationary pressures changing our budget more than anything else is those non-public service contracts, is those private construction contracts. I talked about this before. I can quote over the years other members of the public service that will agree with me because of what they have said that are consistent with my comments. So believe it or not, I'm not actually saying anything that is inconsistent with any individual comments thrown out there because they're true. So I don't expect anything greater from this. But as an example, I'm going to put this out there. You know, at our last finance meeting, we had to raise the budget for one of our construction contracts because the construction contract went up because of COVID. But because the agent makes their money based on the percentage of the contract in its entirety, because the contract just simply went up because of COVID, we had to pay the agent more. Okay. Through no extra work, only because COVID actually increased the cost of the contract. Therefore, we're paying somebody as a percentage of that contract more, even though we have to try and save money because it's a taxpayer budget. That's our responsibility as electeds, to give accountability to the taxpayer why their taxes are going up. So you see, there is an idea of where we could look for constraints, where we could look for accountabilities, savings, and we don't. And that has to do with, well, construction contracts. So I'll leave that for another day. But, you know, if we're going to be talking about these things, we can't ignore, you know, what I just said. I'll leave it at that for now. Thank you.
I'm still processing what you said. So thank you.
It's a lot, Councillor Nason, but you know what? You're on this. I've seen it.
I'll say it on the public record, Councillor Schreier. There's a fair bit that you say these days that you and I see eye to eye on. So not ready to take out a party membership, though.
That's okay. Don't change. I'm not asking anybody to change their political values. I'm asking people to act on them.
No, understood. And I'm just giving you the gears right now. Okay, yes, question or the motion's on the table. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, opposed, carried. Okay, thank you.
That we go into the public hearing.
Okay, we've been moved to go into the public hearing. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, carried. Thank you. Right. Ms. Catherine. Thank you. Are you ready, Madam Clerk? Okay, I'll call this meeting to order. Okay. I didn't get my intro notes, but did I? Yes.
Councillor.
To the top there.
Okay.
Highlighted part, probably, no?
No, I don't have a highlighted part. Pretty much the standard. Yep. Just give me 1 second then. Still learning this. Properly, nope. Okay, I'd like to call this public hearing to order. It is, you know what? Just 5 minute recess, please. Yep. Okay, thank you for the short delay. I'd like to call this meeting to order and acknowledge we are on Treaty 1 territory and Dakota Nation's territory and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. This meeting is the hearing portion, public hearing portion of the East Kildonan and Transcona Community Committee. And today's date is October 25th, 2021. And I'd like to introduce my colleague from North Kildonan, Councillor Jeff Berwadi, my colleague from Elmwood, East Kildonan, Councillor Schreier, and Tamara Pomansky is our clerk. Glenn Doney is our senior planner. Femi Ojo is our planner, area planner, right? Planner, okay. And other members of the public service that are joining us today in support. Madam Clerk.
Sure. So the first items, it's item one and item two. It's item one is subdivision rezoning at 307 and 311 Grassy Boulevard under file DSZ 31 of 2021. And item two is a variance at 307 and 311 Grassy Boulevard under file DAV 179290 of 2021D. I've been advised by the planning department that we will need to adjourn this hearing as it was due to improper posting, but I'll just turn it over to our planner if he wants to explain more so. And then we need motions to adjourn to the next meeting, which will be November 22nd at 10:30 in the morning in the council chamber, 510 Main Street.
Yeah, so advertisements were placed in the newspaper for the rezoning, subdivision rezoning only, as required by the charter. The site was supposed to be posted with a poster that would explain the variances and the rezoning. However, I've just confirmed today that the proponent did not make the poster and did not erect it on the site. And once the applicant, Mr. Wyatt, realized that, he informed us that he'd like everything adjourned to November 22nd. Both items can be held at the same hearing, pretty much at the same time. So we are recommending adjournment as well. As it stands, we cannot even hear the variance application at all. And these two applications should be considered together.
So from that perspective, does this get re-advertised?
The site itself will get reposted, and I haven't checked with land development on whether the ad cut has to go in the newspaper. Pardon me again, I'm not sure about that, but land development will make that call.
Okay, well, I'm curious as the ward counselor as to, because in the past I've put these ad cuts onto my website so the public are aware of these hearings. I need to understand what I'm able to communicate to the residents to make sure that they're aware of this change.
I will look into the matter and inform you after today.
Okay.
Anyone that has called my office, I've let them know that it'll be adjourned to November 22nd, and we have folks that are already registered for that meeting.
That was presumptive. Okay. Council Barotti, do you want to move that for me or?
Sure, I'll move the adjournment.
Okay.
To the, I will move the adjournment to the November 22nd meeting, Winnipeg City Hall, 510 Main Street, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3B1B9 at 10:30 a.m. in the council chamber. Well, no, we don't even put the room, just at City Hall.
Is it Central Standard or Central Daylight?
That's a good question. Actually, that'll actually be relevant. And Council Barotti, you're essentially saying the next regularly scheduled meeting.
That is exactly what I'm saying, but I think you do have to specify an exact date and time and address. Right.
That's why I gave the honor to him. So, okay.
Fair enough.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Okay. Ready for item three? Item, Chair, you ready to move to item three? Okay.
Absolutely.
Item three is a zoning agreement amendment at 820 Kimberly Avenue under file ZAA5 of 2021. The process that committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and then those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made, however, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you've been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. I'll now turn it over to the public service, Femi, to give an overview.
Good morning, councillors. The item that we considered this morning is 820 Kimberly Avenue. This property was rezoned in 1976 to C2, which is a community commercial. And as part of that rezoning, a zoning agreement was placed on that particular approval, which limits the use on that property to a postal carrier station. So over the years, in 1996, there was an amendment to that zoning agreement to allow more uses on that property. So now we have an applicant that wants to establish a kennel, which is more like a dog daycare on that property. But because of the existing zoning agreement that prohibits or that only allows just one use, which is a postal service station, a zoning agreement amendment is required. And the Urban Planning Division is supportive of this zoning agreement amendment. But basically what we have done is to, because the existing zoning agreement is no longer relevant, given that it was placed in 1976. And what we've done is to kind of discharge the whole agreement in its entirety and then replace it with a new one. So under the current C2 zoning district, under the current zoning bylaw, a kennel, a dog daycare is a permitted use. So we are supportive of what is being proposed, and we're supportive of the zoning agreement amendment at this time. Thank you.
I'm good.
Any questions at this point, or we can move to the applicant?
Councillor Schreier, this in your ward?
Yeah, sure. I've got a question. And I guess the question would be, this would either be for the administration or the applicant. And so what type of notice was provided on that property before this hearing?
This is a standard ZA, which means the site will have to be posted or with a standard poster. That this is what is going on. This site is undergoing a zoning agreement amendment, and it's going to be posted on site with the name of the planner. And up to this moment, I've not received any call.
Say that last sentence again.
I said up to this time of this meeting, I didn't receive any call from the neighborhood.
Thank you.
No further questions?
Okay. We have the applicant here. It's Sean Bennett, and he's joining us remotely. Hi, Sean.
Hello. Thank you very much. In response to the last question, we actually took it upon ourselves to go and talk to the folks that back onto the property on Hershey. And all of them were very welcoming to us, to the community. I would like to note that Happy Tales operates two other facilities in the city, and we've never ever had any issues with residents. We are very, very good corporate citizens, and we want to do the best. I actually grew up in Valley Gardens. My mom lives on Blantyre, one block over. My brother lives on Lemon, not far away. And everyone that they've talked to is very excited to have this service in the area, because as you know, more and more people have pets. So thank you for the time today. That's all I have to say.
Okay. Oh, Councillor Bawadi's got his hand up.
Thank you. Do either of your current locations back on to single family homes?
Sorry, did you hear the question that was asked?
No, I didn't hear the question, sorry.
Oh, sorry. Do either of your current locations, you said you have two current locations open in the city, do either of them back onto single family homes?
Yes, in fact, our one on St. Anne's is significantly closer. Our fence actually borders the actual property, and the facility is less than half the distance as compared to the properties on Hershey.
As a new dog owner, how do you control the dogs from barking?
Well, most of because of the zoning on this property, we actually have to have all the dogs inside. With the C2 zoning, all operations have to be inside. So you're not going to hear, this is a brick building built to federal standards. You're not going to hear any dogs.
I know the building. This is the former post office, right?
Yep, exactly. Yep. And our property, even though we do have dogs outside on our St. Anne's property with a conditional use permit, we control the dogs, and in as well, we have internally with our own corporate policy that we don't allow known barkers to be outside. And we're very diligent with clients that come to us, that if we notice that their dogs are barking outside, even when they're picking up or dropping off, we ask for them to monitor that, because as I said, we don't want any issues with our residents. We want to be good corporate citizens.
Very good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Schreier, do you have any questions?
No, I don't.
Oh, our planner has some comments.
Yes, I just want to say something in response to what the owner just said, that this property is on C2, and their canal is a permitted use, but with a use specific standard that kind of says all operations must be inside the building, so there won't be any dog running around or backing into the,
And to me, that means, therefore, that if there were, like on St. Anne's Road, I think Mr. Bennett mentioned, if the dogs were to be outside, they would have to apply for a conditional use.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
So to understand, this would be somewhere where you bring your dog for the day for a shorter period of time. Like you wouldn't, if we're going to Mexico for a week, we don't drop the dog off at your shop.
Yes, they do. Actually, yeah, we offer daycare, which is a day-to-day thing, obviously, kenneling, or we call it a hotel, as well as grooming.
So the pet gets a holiday too.
It's an all-inclusive resort.
Question I have is based on location. And I know we've had prior hearings and deals and stuff on nearby. More of environmental. Since the residents are canines, environmentally, is there any concerns on that site? Like, have you done air quality or radon gas checks, specifically due to being adjacent to a former landfill?
Absolutely. There was a phase one ESA done in 2006, I believe it was.
2006?
Yeah.
Good year.
Okay. Okay, that's all I have.
Councillor Nason, you say it's K9 and the school across the street is 9 to 12. Hope we don't get any confusion there, despite what some of the teachers might say about their students, but I think we'll get that straight.
Perhaps there's an opportunity for KE to get some on the job real training with K9. So there we go.
We'd be happy to have it.
That's not an unrealistic proposition, Councillor Nason. Good point. They offer excellent trade education at Kildonan East, and who's to say? Thank you.
All right, carrying on.
I have no further questions.
I don't have anyone further registered in support. And is there anyone in the gallery that would like to speak in support or opposition or for information? And I have no one else registered, so we can proceed to motions if you're ready, Councillor.
So the public service has nothing further to add?
Sorry, questions, any further questions of the public service?
Okay. Councillor Schreier, do you have any questions of the public service?
I do not.
Councillor Roy, okay.
I don't know, we always know how dogs react around the mailman coming to the door. I'm just wondering if there's gonna be that aura of former mail carriers in that building. I'm just kidding.
My only concern is traffic in that area can be somewhat challenging at peak school time. So was there any sort of traffic study undertaking?
No, because they have an on-site parking that we would take what the traffic will be on that site. And then there wasn't any variances for parking at this time. So it is expected that parking will be met on site.
Okay. Did you catch that, Councillor Schreier?
Yes.
Okay, are you prepared to move a motion?
Yes, I am.
Does the applicant have anything else to say?
Retort.
Yeah.
Sean, you have a chance if you wanted to address any other comments that have been made. No new information is permitted, but to speak in rebuttal to any comments made.
No, thank you. No, I'm good to go.
Councillor Schreier, are you prepared to move this motion?
Yes, I am, if I may. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the appropriate standing committee, as our great clerk will tell us. Which one is it? Is it EPC or
Executive Policy Committee?
Executive Policy Committee. Thank you.
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the following supporting reasons be provided. This is a reasonable, very reasonable application and change. I believe there is adequate notice given to the neighborhood. Our councillors have challenged this as well with their questioning. I think this is an appropriate a change of zoning for an appropriate commercial service to be provided for the community, as expressed by Mr. Bennett. And I wish all good success in this endeavor, providing this service for our community.
Do I do all those in favor on that? For okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Last one.
And I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carry.
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted, and all persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
Okay, thank you very much. I believe so.
Item four is a demolition at 713 Moncton Avenue under file demo 216527 of 2021. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and then those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and were only permitted to speak when called upon. Once you've been heard, you can either remain in the YouTube or in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue watching live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your player now. We'll turn it over to Femi to give an overview.
A couple of months ago, we had a variance on this property to establish two residential zoning lots. The property is currently zone R1, so the owner applied to have two zoning lots in which the urban plan division supported. So the owner is now coming back to say he wants to remove the existing single family dwelling on site in order that two new single family dwelling can be built on that particular land. And to remove an existing single family dwelling without an approved building permit, it will require an approver, a demo approver from this committee. And to be very clear, this building is not going to be demolished according to the applicants. Basically what he's doing is to remove it from where it is currently and move it to a different location. But whether you're demolishing or you're moving to a different site, a demo permit or a demo approver is required. And that is why we're here. The planning division is supportive of this application, given that as according to the applicant, plans are currently being drawn and there won't be any delay in terms of new buildings coming up on this site. Thank you.
Councilor Schreier.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Nason. So we say demolition, it's actually being moved, and that's fine. Good luck with that. But there's more than one building here. So we're talking about a house, we're talking about a garage. What are we talking about in terms of demolition to be sure? Whether you know they're moving it, not demolishing it, that's fine. Are they moving both or are they demolishing one and moving one?
Is that this site is 713 Moncton and there's only one building on site on lot 66.
Okay, I'm sorry. It looks to me like I'm looking at the aerial view and it shows a garage in the back on the same side of the lot as the house on the west side of the lot near the back. That's what I thought I am looking at.
Yes, there's a garage there, but the application is for the removing of the existing single family house on site.
So the garage is remaining?
I can't really speak to that, but I guess during the original variance application, I think the intent is to demolish everything on site for two new single family vacant lots.
I wouldn't be surprised if the garage, a notably smaller and different building, isn't judged under the same bylaws or regulations. That's fine, and I guess I'll speak with the applicant about that as long as we have an understanding. And that's fine. I have no further questions at this time of the administration.
Yeah.
Except, I guess I could ask now. I could ask the applicant, but if the administration wishes to answer this, that is in terms of giving fair notice to the community and how that was done.
It's as a demo application is the same standard. The site will have been posted for 14 days and prior to this public hearing.
Okay, and because we need to do it this way with a hearing, that's because you're not supposed to demolish unless you have a new building permit. In this case, there's no actual new building permit, and that is why we need the hearing to allow.
That is why we're here.
Yep.
So the way it works is if the applicant has a building permit, you can as well go and demolish because you have a building permit. But because it doesn't have one, then he has to apply for a demo.
Thank you, Mr. Ojo. Thank you.
Okay, Madam Clerk.
Okay, the applicant, Patrick Calario, wasn't able to attend. However, he is David Andrew Jovich. Is here on his behalf, so you can please come on down to the podium and you have up to 10 minutes to speak to the committee.
Hi, my name is David and I'm here to address any questions or concerns you guys have.
Okay, Councillor Schreier, do you have any questions?
All right, so it seems pretty straightforward. Notice was given, and in terms of, was there any need to discuss anything with the neighbors that you're aware?
No, not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay, fair enough. And is the garage in question here as well?
The garage is actually what's referred to as garage is actually a small shed. I believe it to be less than 10 feet by 10 feet. Mm-hmm. So we were going to have that just stay on site. It's a relatively small structure.
This is, yeah. Excuse me. It's a shed, not a garage. And thank you very much. And I have no further questions. And thank you.
Seeing nothing else. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, guys.
He needs to remain in case retort.
David, did you just want to hang out here for a second?
Just in case you hear anything that comes after. Yeah.
And I don't have anyone else registered in support, and there's no one in the chamber. I don't have anyone registered in opposition. And again, there's no one in the chamber or for information. So
did we receive correspondence, Madam Clerk, on this one? I thought we had.
I think that was from David Bonarczyk for the park plan approval. I don't think so. I'll double check. Okay.
See for sure.
I thought we received an email correspondence, but it was
extension of time. I'll support the extension of time.
All I received was plans from David.
It was on a social post that I had put about another hearing that we've now adjourned, but they were retorting with regards to this matter.
Nothing had come to my office. Fine. Yeah.
Sorry, okay. That was my apologies.
Any questions for the public service?
Councillor Schreier, any questions? No.
Okay. No, I'm ready to move motions. Okay.
Very well. Move away.
Thank you. Thank you.
Not literally move away, but move your motion.
There's a year before the election, Councillor. What are you saying? Anyway, I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the criteria under Part 9, Section 46.3 of Development Procedures Bylaw Number 104/2020 are satisfied.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
And I move that the public hearing with with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered. And that concludes our public hearings for today.
Okay. We'll take 5 minutes then reconvene for our regular meeting.
Sure.
Okay, thank you. And we're now returning to our original agenda, a regular meeting of the East Kildonan and Transcona Community Committee. And yeah, let's go, Madam Clerk.
We're on item two, proposed sale of the city-owned property located at 1121 Wabasha Street. And we do have members of the public service online.
Okay. Mr. Patay and who, sorry.
Yep, good morning. Ward Chapel here from the real estate branch. So we've drafted a report which indicates proposed new site for the sale of the Roland Michener Arena. In the schedule of the report, specifically Schedule C, it identifies the new boundaries of the proposed sale area, which is roughly 5,600 square meters. That's a decrease of approximately 1,300 square meters from the original declaration of surplus, which was roughly 7,000 square meters. What we've tried to strike the balance of is finding a appropriately sized development parcel that does not severely impact the park's area. So the residual portion of parkland located at the southwest corner of Horton Avenue East and Wabasha Street would still be large enough for a playground, passive park, or some other parks uses. So Parks was supportive of that boundary. It would result in the elimination of that diamond at that corner, which was already undersized to begin with. So as part of this proposed sale, there would be restoration work required and paid out of the sale proceeds in order to restore that that diamond area to a green space in the interim until some future use is identified. As we've noted before, the servicing on Wabasha is a concern as there is no mains to in that location. So there would need to be an extension of mains for any type of multifamily or other development that might occur there. So again, trying to find the right size that justifies those investments is what the public service is trying to obtain.
So in the past, this site had RMFL zoning. Was that accurate?
It was approved by council, but not enacted. The city can't enter into agreements with itself. So we had the approvals in place, but required the developer or purchaser to finalize those agreements. Since we weren't able to sell, the RMFL zoning has lapsed.
You did mention playground or passive. There's a big difference between the two of those, a couple hundred thousand dollars usually. How, under what undertaking, would that be land operating reserve that you would utilize for that?
Well, the sale proceeds of this arena would follow the Ralph policy, which is an investment into recreation and leisure. If for some reason it didn't qualify as that, I think the recommendation through the sale would be to restore that land. And then there could be a subsequent motion recommending further proceeds redirected, but the existing policies would prevail between operating reserve and Ralph.
We see more and more of the park prep, at least prep wise, is cut. So I'm worried that we're going to end up with a situation where we have a large multifamily and no playground for them to play at in the area. Because where is the next closest park to this one for play structure? Just trying to think about it in my head.
Yeah, offhand, I'm not 100% sure. I guess you've got a school nearby.
Yeah.
And the next
Middle school.
Yeah. And
at the end of Harold, there's a small junior park.
So I guess on Dowling, there's a few different sites.
Yeah.
North, and then some school properties to the east.
Yeah.
There's a bit of a smattering of parks and sort of open spaces in that general area.
So the slightly smaller footprint of the undertaking, I think it goes from 18% of the park being absorbed to 13, down to 13%? Is that accurate?
That's about correct, yes.
Okay, so that's more in alignment with city policy under our Winnipeg 2045 to preserve green space?
Yeah, as much as possible. I mean, the north boundary is somewhat flexible. We could look to shrink that even further. It just then creates the question of, is that a large enough development opportunity? So, you know, it's a bit like chasing our tail. We could look to shift that further south and mark it. And if that's unsuccessful, we could play with that boundary. So I just didn't want to get in a situation where we're in a constant cycle of marketing the property, trying to find the right size, and you know, the general markets sort of lose interest as we don't really have a set idea of what we want.
This has been kicked around for probably close to 10 years, this piece of property. And I know residents are interested in it. Some would like to see it remain as recreation and sell it to adult for a dollar to area groups, but I can understand the valuation on it. I want to be, you know, clear on the public record with regards to any sort of preparation, demolition, restoration of the property. Are we using land operating reserve on that?
We're going to push that expense to the purchaser. It was previously suggested that the public service take on that responsibility. And that was a result of unsuccessful attempts previously to get this sold. There was some opposition to that concept, so we've reverted back to the original position that the cost to demolish and abate would be the purchase responsibility, and the city would just be responsible for a small amount of demolition between the arena and the service garage to the south.
So the sensitive areas we'll take care of. Will the purchase price in real estate side of things, will that be reflective of the undertaking with regards to demolishing and remediation of the site?
It should, but it's always a question of demand. And you know, we see this quite a bit with city properties. There's often a lot of demand for these as land is in short supply. So in some cases, purchasers will pay a premium to acquire site and might not take a full discount of demolition and abatement. Can't give you a certain answer until we actually market it and find out what the responses are.
Okay. With regards to the undertaking of the park restoration, this may be for the clerk to help articulate, but it was something that, you know, since it's in the ward, the decision on what that looks like, how do we get that to come back to here for our lens as a community committee as to what future it looks like?
Right now, this is the council directed for this to come back to our committee. And then right now the recommendation is just to receive it as information. Did you wanted something else added to this?
Well, I would certainly like to see that corner, that play field that will no longer be a baseball field. When there's a report to convert it, right? Because it can't be converted and taken away until such time as a plan for the site happens. Any restoration of that to either a passive or a playground, that decision comes back to here.
Gord, would you guys be doing that report or?
I wonder, would you consider, I guess, either laying this over for 30 days or asking us to report back just verbally? We could engage with Parks and Community Services and then detail the RALF policy. Maybe further identify if the desire was to get a playground there, what the steps would be.
We actually have, I believe, Shauna from Parks Department. Could we just have a quick conversation, Shauna, on this?
I know you're here for another item, but Councillor Nason's wondering if maybe you can assist or provide some advice.
Hi.
Sorry to catch you off guard on this, but you know, I know the public service has been working to try to move this item on Michener, and I know it's an item of interest to the community. The baseball field, or the Little League field, that's at the corner of Horton and Wabasha. Under the report we're dealing with about the Michener site, would need to be converted either to a passive park or a playground. Understanding the financial issues we have with regards to playgrounds, is it something, I'm trying to figure out a way that we can deal with this matter and have it come back to here for oversight on the perspective of what ends up, if it's passive or an actual playground. Any site that you can provide on that?
I do know that there are a number of playgrounds within walking distance to this site. So in terms of being able to, for replacement of amenities in long-term in Transcona, I don't know if a playground at this site is required because there are a number within walking distance. But I definitely think, well, the removal of the infield of the baseball diamond will be important. And adding the sod to the space, perhaps a sitting area. It would be nice to see how it could potentially work with whatever the property becomes. For example, if it's a multifamily, maybe a nice sitting area that can work for all of the community as well as the new residents would be nice. But perhaps we could discuss this with you. Perhaps there could be a motion that we discuss it with you as counselor, what we would like to see happen at that site
prior to formal blah blah
right.
blah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Gord, Mark, any thoughts? Are you?
Yeah,
I don't want to belabor this.
No. All good, counselor. Sorry for interrupting, but yeah, Shauna makes a great point. It would be good to know what will be developed on the site in question and something that would be complementary. I think outside of the report for the declaration of surplus and sale for this property, community could likely pass a new business motion requesting that the public service consult with the community committee in advance of any restoration or improvements to the passive park adjacent to the site in question.
Madam Clerk, you have that? No? Okay, and that would be a new business. Mark, if you don't mind sending a quick email to our clerk so she can get the language, that would assist us in this decision-making process, I think. Okay. All right. With that last bit that Mark has provided, I think I'm prepared to make a move, unless Councillor Berwati wants to do it. Do you want to take the chair?
Sure.
I'll move that the report of the public service be received as information.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you very much, everyone. I'll pass the chair back.
Okay. All right. We have an extension of time request for 1454 Revelston West. We have nobody from the public service for this one, Madam Clerk?
No, I guess. I guess who the author wrote this was Greg Jasper. Daniel was here earlier, but it was for the public hearing items. So no, there's no one here for public service for this.
Okay. And do we have to move this today? Is there?
We could lay it over. It's got to go through the whole process all the way up to council, but we could lay it over.
Yeah, I would like to lay it over because there are some things in this area that are challenging, to say the least. So,
okay. For next meeting? Or when did you want to lay
it over? Yeah, no, that's fine.
I'll move way over to the next meeting.
Okay, the motion has been heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Okay. And for park plan approval? Devonshire Park Public Reserves A and B.
Shauna, did you want to speak to the item at all, or
I can. I think David covered it pretty well with his description of what's being proposed. I just wanted to say it's a condition of the development agreement that it received plan approval at community committee. So that's unique to this project. We have as administration reviewed the project quite a few times with the applicant and are happy with what is being proposed. If you have any questions, please let me know.
Yep, I got questions.
Okay.
Garbage cans, was indicated earlier that the collection factored into this. I see on the corner park, there's only one on the northeast corner. Is that the only one that's in that park?
That's right.
Okay, so the public service doesn't think that people will be interested in depositing garbage on the south west corner at all as they walk through?
Well, so these development agreements only have a requirement that they grade level and sod the public reserve, as well as providing pathways. So those are the minimum requirements. So whatever the developer is willing to give is above and beyond that. So we work with the developer to provide the best for the community. And that is what they had suggested. It could use another garbage can at the other end of the path. We certainly prefer to see garbage cans only at the path entry, because that's easier to empty. And it also, we want to avoid the seating areas, because that's when the wasps create issues with that. So
the challenge, I know I can't speak for my colleagues, but the challenge I have is after this, the only opportunity to add garbage cans is to take away from somewhere else. But when new developments come up, that's the opportunity to have the appropriate amount of garbage cans or perceived appropriate amount added to the inventory. In this case, I see one on that northwest or northeast. Understanding that it's a busy corner at Transcona Boulevard and Peguis, only to get busier as it becomes four lanes on Peguis. But people still will be transiting through that area. Is there an opportunity to add another garbage receptacle at this time for the city to be doing the collection on that corner?
From an administration point of view, that would be acceptable. So it'd be up to the developer if they were willing to provide that.
Yeah, because the other question I have is with regards to benching, and the short period of time since I've been in office, I've learned culturally appropriate seating pertaining to some of our community that resides in this area. And there's a need for separated areas for benches because male groups do not sit with female groups generally. So I've had to add a bunch of benches in community parks. In this case, the only benches that I see are centrally located in that corner park. Again, much like the receptacles, is there an opportunity for additional benches to be added?
And with regards to the corner park, and I know I've definitely had that experience as well with different cultural groups, and I do tend to see that happen more often around playgrounds, where there is an area where the females will sit in an area where the males will sit. So I could see your point around the playground. With regards to the corner park, I think that actually creates a really great meeting area for members of the community, especially because it is congregating together in parks is a very, very popular activity. So I think that would actually create a really nice space for that. I think maybe your concern may be related to the playground area, but there are still two seating areas in the playground area on either side of the pavement area. So that might help with that.
I can certainly see the requests already. I know that they would come after this is established. I saw it in, Kildonan Meadows Park, maybe. Behind Sobeys. It's around a play field, and there was a request shortly after I was elected to have additional seating on that away from the playground, you know, and around the soccer field. again, I have limited ward budgets, limited prep budgets, as do the public service. So from a perspective of around what's designated as Lakeside Park, south and north in our report today, is there any in between, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 sites that may warrant additional benches? Because the developer can certainly do them a lot less than what is prescribed from the public service.
Perhaps if David's still available, he can speak to the design and addition of potential addition of amenities.
Councillor Nason, I definitely understand your point. And I could see potentially in the lake, in the Lakeside Park, having a bench node perhaps midway. So if you're looking at a drawing on the north side, there's a part where a path comes in from George Barone. So we could create a bit of a node right there and then have something sort of right in the middle. So three different seating areas. We do have two benches at each of those lake parks and four at the a corner park. As far as the corner park goes, there's not really an optimal place to put another bench. It would feel a bit awkward, but we could put one on the path. What I've been instructed, you know, with all due respect to the committee's requests, is that we balance the budget where it is. And so if we add some benches, then perhaps we could if it's acceptable to remove some trees or something just to make sure that our numbers are staying where they are. We are relatively overplanted in some places to create effect, so I think it would have a negligible impact on quality of space. But if that's acceptable to you, we could I would suggest benches at the George Barone pathway intersection, perhaps
one additional bench. And I'd be looking at one additional receptacle. Where are the receptacles park on Lakeside?
So at either end, the north and south extreme ends, as you come into the park, that you'll see there's a little node where there'll be a park sign and a trash receptacle. We want to make sure we're placing them in areas where city staff can easily get to them. On that corner park right at Peguis and Transcona, there isn't an ideal location to park for a city truck to come in. Now, you know, Shauna could probably talk to that better than me, but, you know, we're trying to make it convenient for unloading as well.
Understood. They would park in the subdivision and, you know, much like the residents were expecting them to walk from one corner to the other corner to place in a receptacle. Guess what happens? They don't, right? So, you know, this is likely gonna be a busy corner. Hopefully we'll get the active transportation fixed along this route and people will be on bikes on that southwest corner as opposed to having to walk their bicycles because of some failure to get together and plan properly. Okay, thank you.
Can I take the chair?
Yeah, take the chair. Okay. Hearing what the presentations have presented, I understand. I do want to move having an additional garbage can. And Shauna, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but they can easily walk from one side of that where they would park safely in that subdivision. My map doesn't show me the adjunct street where that garbage can is on the northwest corner or northeast corner. But can they not transit through that area to empty a receptacle? Do they not do that in other parks?
Likely they would drive over the path to get there. I don't know if that's the best scenario, but I would have to defer to Public Works on how they would empty it. They could potentially walk from one end of the park to the other. I just don't know how realistic that is with their timelines and and schedule of emptying.
Well, it is disappointing because You know, I know you guys have been working on this for a while.
Our path is rated for a vehicle. It is the city detail parkway path. Pardon me for interjecting. But it is only 2.5 meters wide, I believe. And so it would be a very tight fit for a vehicle. I would have some concerns that they would not keep their tires on.
Only rated for walking then, not for cycling?
Oh, cycling
as well.
Yeah.
I thought it was 3 meter for cycling.
Our multi-use paths in our park spaces tend to be a little bit smaller simply because of the size of the park. And also it's not as, there's not as much traffic as one of the standard active transportation routes because it's more leisurely use.
Okay. All right. I'll concede on the garbage bin. It is problematic for me though. Where I won't though is I want to add a bench at the George Borough Bay entrance or on the park side of the entry that would be for George Borough Bay.
That's acceptable to us.
All right.
Provided maybe we delete two or three trees just to make sure the budget.
No, I'm not going to delete any trees. That's a plus one.
Understood.
Just to clarify, Chair, you just wanted one additional bench on the park side to the entry of George Borough Bay, correct?
On the along adjacent to the circular path. Either on the north west or the southwest side. I'm assuming that's Shauna, that would be the appropriate placement for a bench in that corner.
So facing the pond, is that where we're? Yeah.
As determined by the public service.
Chair, you didn't want to, nothing about receptacle? No, just.
No, I'm going to concede on that one. I wanted to make note that it is a challenge in the public. So hopefully we'll have a residents association formed in that area and community cleanups will help address any refuse issues.
Okay. Very good. Motion's been heard. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. I'll pass the chair back. This is for item number 5, non-conforming approach at 680 Knowles Avenue, North Cordonan Ward.
Yeah. Do we need to hear from the public service or are you good to go?
Is there anybody from the public service on the line? No.
No? We're left to our own device.
I was going to ask maybe a question about the depth of the ditch, but there's nobody there. I will then move the public service recommendation that it be approved.
Just prior to calling the question, that's for the clerk. I noticed that in the recommendation that the be approved is now bolded and underlined.
Oh, you want reasons, don't you, Madam Clerk?
Supporting comments, but we there's two motions for the non-conforming approach. So that the recommendation of the public service
be concurred in and that the application for the non-conforming approach be approved.
Okay. Do
you want to give your supporting reasons now, or
it's supposed to be two motions?
I'll call the question on that, and then the second question on the supporting comments. Yeah.
All right, I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move the following supporting reasons. This is a very large lot located in a area with a rural cross section unpaved roadway. Again, as per the public service recommendation, they have no concerns with the approach. It appears there's perhaps some other approaches in the area that are also above the standard 6.5 meter wide. So those are my supporting reasons.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move. Any new business?
Yes.
Okay.
Suspension of the rules to hear new business.
So moved.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Now, Clerk Pomanski, I haven't.
Mark Pate did send an email.
Okay, I've been busy, so.
You may want to read, yeah, read it, his recommendation first.
Okay. Okay. I see what he's talking about. So it's basically, if I don't do it now, I have till council to do something. Because at the SPC, I don't have a voice, so. Okay, I have no new business then.
Okay.
Anyone else?
I'll move consent to adjournment.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, carried, we are adjourned.